Network. And today's topic is be where you are when you're there. We go through so many emotions, particularly when life feels chaotic, that it can feel like a roller coaster. And it might even cause us to question our sanity. But our best bet for integration and healing and making that transition with as much grace as possible is to be where we are when we're there. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. And before we get started, hello, good morning, Rosalyn. Welcome, welcome. Great to start the week with you. Let's see. I just got these new glasses. I'm sort of getting used to them just for the computer, which is pretty cool. Anyway, let's take a minute or two to get present before we dig in. Let's take a deep breath in through your nose and hold it. And imagine clean, crisp oxygen flooding your lungs, flowing into your bloodstream, nourishing all your cells, all your organs, bringing vital life energy to your body and being. And as you exhale, exhale any tension, stress, negativity, fatigue. And now let's take another deep breath in through your nose and hold it. This time, imagine brilliant, bright light lighting you up from the inside out, illuminating, electrifying, and energizing all your cells, all your molecules, all your electrons, creating a brilliant beam of light and energy from your heart out into the world. And as you exhale, exhale any tension, stress, negativity, fatigue. And now let's hold our hands together and rub your hands, your palms together to feel the friction, the temperature, the pressure, the motion, and the tickling and tingling when you stop. And allow all those sensations to bring you present right here, right now, into this remarkable physical form that enables us to experience life. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So, in times of upheaval, times of grief, times of endings, new beginnings, times of transitions, our emotions can be all over the place. And I'm going to speak to this particularly around grieving, that when we've lost someone that we love, we experience such a gamut of emotions. There's the grieving, there's the grief and the devastation and the brokenheartedness. And then at other moments, it's like it doesn't even exist. And we could be laughing or cavorting. And then the grief returns, and the upset, maybe anger, frustration, all a whole spectrum of crazy emotions that have us bouncing around like a ping pong ball. And it could be crazy making if we don't compassionately allow for the fact that emotion is not a continuum. So the thing about emotion is that it is energy in motion. So we don't stay in the same state perpetually. So when people say, "I'm depressed," for example, or I'm furious about whatever circumstance it might be presenting. The thing is that we're not always depressed every moment. We actually move through a spectrum of emotions, and we choose to recognize one particular emotion and characterize, paint the whole experience with the same brush. But the truth is that we're all over the place. We're all over the place. And it's hard to reconcile that. Partly because sometimes we feel that we should be feeling a particular way, for one. And so that makes us maybe even feel guilty or ashamed if we're not feeling that way at a given moment. But it also makes us sort of cancel out the fact that we're not always in that dark state. And I'm finding this really interesting for myself, as my beloved Jewel that I've talked to you about, my 18 and a half year old cat is passing. And so I'm going through this crazy roller coaster ride, where there are moments when I'm fine. There are moments when I'm able to just be loving with her and even reminisce with her in a joyful way and laugh and just love. And there are other moments where I'm just overcome by sorrow and grief. And I know I'm not alone in that kind of experience with this vast range of emotions. And I think that our healing and our integration is reliant upon being able to be where we are when we're there, to be in grief when we're in grief, to be in joy when we're in joy, to be in whatever emotions may arise, even emotions like regret or love, you know, to be in any of those places when we're there without resisting that, without judging it, because it's crazy. It's crazy. Thank you, Rosalind. Ooh. Yeah, I think this is going to be for the next few days at least. Well, it is going to be for the next few days unless she passes sooner. Yeah, I thought I could do this. I couldn't really be here and not talk about it because it's so present. But I thought I'd be able to. You know, I thought I'd be able to keep it together. But I have to be where I am. I'm, you know, yeah. So I think we've probably all experienced the loss of loved ones. And the loss comes in waves. Anyone who's experienced it, it experiences those waves. The same with fear, you know. So, pretty much all of our emotions move in waves. And our best bet is to ride those waves as they occur. rather than trying to swim in the other direction, because those waves are going to catch up with us one way or another. And I've worked with multiple clients who have suffered losses of family members, parents, and in their lives, they had to put on a brave face. They had stuff to do, things to take care of. And as a result of pushing through that and being stalwart and quote unquote strong, I say quote unquote because this notion of being strong, meaning don't grieve, don't give in. How about that language? Don't give in to your emotions is something that we're deeply conditioned to, that somehow that is worthy of merit, that that is to just put on a brave face. Just the language of that is we're hiding ourselves from others and from ourselves. And by not allowing those emotions an outlet, that's energy. That's energy that's going to get stuck. I actually had an experience of that the other day. It was so bizarre. It was really interesting. I had all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I didn't do anything, but I had a deep stabbing pain on the left side of my back where my lungs are. And it was kind of a crippling pain. It was like a torqued muscle. And the lungs are associated with grief. And I hadn't really cried about Jewel. And that pain persisted until I just wept. I wept and wept, and the pain went away. The pain went away. It was my body saying, you need to grieve. You need to express that emotion. You need to release that energy. And when I did, it was gone. I thought I was going to have to go to the chiropractor. It was crippling. But I just wailed and wailed, and then it was gone. And so our bodies have a deep intelligence about how to utilize and mobilize these energies that move through us as emotion. And it's so important. It's so important that we be respectful of our body and our being, the need for our body and being to process these energies, these emotions. And the thing is that it can make you feel crazy, because in one moment you can't stop crying, in another moment you may be laughing hysterically, or and they say laughter and crying is a similar release. But we're not static beings. We're not static beings. So characterizing ourselves as such really limits us from our experience. To say I'm depressed, which I have been in my life. I've gone through deep, deep, deep depression for most of my life until, until the last number of years. But deep, deep, deep depression. And I would characterize myself as I'm depressed rather than in this moment, I feel depressed or I feel sad or, seeing it as an overarching condition rather than parts, a part of a variable, maybe a weighted variable, but a variable for sure. So, we go through such a range. And sometimes it can happen so fast that we really feel like we're like an echocardiogram or something all over the spectrum, just bouncing all over. And so it's important to have grace for, to give ourselves grace, to have compassion for those erratic kinds of shifts. Because it's not necessarily a gradual shift from one emotion to another. I think learning compassion for ourselves around emotion is a really important thing, that the suppression does damage. Like I can my back being an example, and I'm quite certain that that's, that I'm not alone in that, that we've all had outpicturing of emotion or repressed emotion that has become physical. So oftentimes when people are grieving, they get a cold, for example, and when they're not allowing themselves to express, because again, that's lungs and there's so much sorrow there. So to be able to express that is an important thing. And I get that there's not, it's not always the perfect venue to do that. I get that we sometimes need to find a moment in private to be able to just express the emotion that's there. It's just that it's an important thing to do. It like grief can affect your heart directly, as well as your lungs, your whole body and being. Right? And anger can too. When we allow ourselves to be angry instead of to feel angry, it's toxic. Those emotions are more toxic to us than they are to the person or circumstance that we're angry about, right? So it we sort of end up consuming ourselves with those emotions if we don't find a way to release that energy. In and especially with anger, rather than acting out, there that we get to find productive ways, safe ways to release these emotions and relieve ourselves to get that energy moving. But the biggest impediment to that is just our culture that demonizes emotion, that belittles emotion, that associates emotion with weakness or with unreliability or any all kinds of other negative type associations, when emotion is oftentimes our North Star. It's often our emotional response to something that allows us to know what's right and what's wrong. You know, where something shows up and there's an emotional reaction, it's important to look into that emotional reaction, not to override it by just say by dismissing it as emotion and therefore less than some kind of quote unquote rational decision or perspective. Rosalind says, so emotion and thoughts are different things. I think they are. I think they are. I think thoughts can elicit emotions, and I think emotions can elicit thoughts, but I don't think that they're necessarily, I don't think they're the same thing. They're connected. They can be very deeply connected, but I don't think they're the same thing. When we have an emotion about something, there's an associated thought. When we reframe, recreate that thought, the emotion shifts. And sometimes when we are able to shift our emotion, the thought changes too. You know, when we're able to find something to be happy about, then the way that we think about things is different. So it's they are intimately connected, but I don't think that they are the same thing. We can think one thing and feel another also. And that's when we're out of alignment. That's when, like, we'll try to rationalize and convince ourselves of certain things. But still, emotionally, whatever we rationalize, we can understand it, we can justify it, but emotionally, it still can feel so completely wrong. So, in those cases, in our culture, the tendency is to override the emotion and to go with the reasonable, rational choice. But the thing is that the emotions are informed by a whole bunch of things. They're informed by our history. So we get to look at, is it based on trauma? Or is there something more there? But our emotions are responding to a whole bunch of information that we're not necessarily consciously perceiving. Because we pick up all kinds of information on all kinds of levels that we don't necessarily consciously recognize. For instance, just simple things like we can notice. Even though it might not be conscious, we can notice that someone's sweating or that their eyes are set in a certain way. I mean, you've probably seen dogs that when their eyes are set in a certain way, you know they're going to attack. So you can see that in a person, but you don't necessarily think their eyes are set in a certain way and it's danger. You know, all the muscles in their face are in a certain configuration that can alarm you and alert you. But you might not be consciously saying, I know what that is. And yet you have an emotional response. So there's an intelligence to our emotions, and there's an intelligence to our body. Like just the idea that I experienced that deep pain because I was having such grief that I hadn't expressed. And so we are just such a wonderful compilation of communication and experience. And as we become more versed in recognizing and honoring that experience, we can evolve and grow and learn and transform. It's super powerful. Super, super powerful. Every opportunity in life is an opportunity for growth. Every experience that we have is an opportunity for awakening, including witnessing ourselves and being present through very difficult circumstances. Circumstances of sorrow, circumstances of rage, circumstances of frustration, of victimhood, of all kinds of circumstances. It's who we are as we bring ourselves to those circumstances that allow us to grow and expand and awaken. And so today's topic, be where you are when you're there. That is about be here now, right? It is about being present. Be where you are when you're there without resistance, allowing life to flow through us. And the more we allow life to flow through us, the more our lives will be in flow. So that's it for today. I'm Mira Rubin. This is The Core Connection. And I go live here each weekday morning at 9 a.m. Eastern on the Enlightened World Network Facebook page and YouTube channel. And I invite you to like and follow the Enlightened World Network Facebook page and YouTube channel and my YouTube channel. The links are in the chat. Rosalind says, my thoughts are with you and your sweet baby. Rosalind, thank you. Thank you, thank you. And so much love to all of you. So much gratitude for the opportunity to spend this time together and being human beings together, learning what that is. So much love.